Hi, everybody, and welcome back to SoC 101, or Everything You Wanted to Know About a Computer But Were Afraid to Ask. I'm Professor Adam Teman of the NX Labs at Bar-Ilan University, and today we're going to give you Lecture 3, From C to Assembler. So, as a continuation of the previous lecture, today we're going to continue focusing on the embedded microprocessor from within our SoC. But today we're going to be looking at it from a bit of a different point of view. So we'll start with some motivation for this lecture. And we're going to start with the C programming language. And what we see over here is the very well-known book by Dennis Ritchie about the C programming language, which I hope many of you have looked into and read before. So it's been over 50 years since C was developed in the early 70s by Dennis Ritchie and Ken Thompson. Interestingly, C is named as a replacement for the language called B that was developed by Ken Thompson. And B, what was it named for? Well, according to Thompson, it was named for his wife, Bonnie. C really became a standard when the ANSI committee was developed, and ANSI C from 1989, C89, is often considered the standard, even though there have been additional standardizations of the language since then. And even though it's so old and many people think it's dated, C is still the preferred language for programming embedded systems today. And why is this? Well, there are many reasons for this. It gives you fine-grained control. It lets you deal with memory management. It gives you very high performance. It lets you do things like bit manipulation. And it's portable and compatible. C, as has been said, is the closest thing to assembly that is not assembly. But hardware runs on binaries. It doesn't run on a high-level language. And that connection between the high-level language and the microarchitecture that we have beneath the binaries, they are given in the instruction set architecture, as we can see here in our stack of different abstractions going from, you know, the low-level physics and the circuits all the way up to the algorithms and problems. We have our programming languages up here, and what connects the programming languages to the microarchitecture is the architecture itself, or the instruction set architecture. It's the interface or the contract between the software and the hardware. And for that, we have a toolchain, which goes from some source files, which are usually in high-level languages, and brings us an executable file that's in architecture-specific machine code. Why does the instruction set architecture matter? Well, I want to give a few different questions. One of them is, why can't Intel sell mobile chips? You know, I don't know if this is still accurate, but a vast majority, maybe 99% or more, of mobile phones, tablets, and so forth are based on the ARM instruction set architecture at its different versions. And on the flip side of that, why can't ARM sell servers? So 99%, and maybe it's less than that today, but it's a vast majority of laptops, desktops, and servers are based on the AMD 64, also known as the x86 64 ISA. And real strange question is, how can IBM still sell mainframes? So we have mainframes built with the IBM 360 ISA, and they're still surviving 50 plus years later. So how can that be? It's because the ISA is the most important interface in computer systems, where the hardware meets the software. But instruction sets do not change. They accrete more instructions. So as we can see here, just a little map of the x86 instruction set from, you know, its start at 1978 or so until, you know, the 2012 in this graph. And you see that more and more instructions were added over the time. It doesn't lose instruction, and that continues to grow. And what that means is that we have to go and be backwards compatible when we develop a new version and we add different instructions. And that's something that is not that great. And another huge problem with these types of proprietary ISAs is that they tend to die out. The fortunes of the proprietary ISAs are tied to the business fortunes and whims of the companies that develop them. So if we take, for example, Digital Equipment Corporation, which was a big leader in the field many years ago, they first developed the PDP, then moved over to the VAX, which was really a workhorse type of operating system and architecture that many, many businesses used. And then moved over to the Alpha ISO, which was a leader and developed many of the concepts we still use in computer architecture today. Basically, with the end of digital, all of that is gone. if we look at MIPS, MIPS was the first probably commercial RISC ISA that really took off and so forth. It was eventually bought by Imagination and then by Wave Computing. Nowadays, interestingly, both MIPS and Imagination still exist as companies, but they both develop RISC-V and not MIPS anymore. So really, MIPS has kind of died off. And Spark, which was what Sun developed and was a big RISC architecture back in the day, and they made really great workstations. They were bought out at some point by Oracle, and basically Spark doesn't exist anymore. And of course, we cannot forget the Intel Itanium, which had the epic, very long instruction word architecture inside, which was supposed to replace all the architectures used by servers. And it just really, really never took off. And it is like the Titanic of all of computer technology. So open interfaces that are not proprietary, they work for software. We take, our Penguin over here from Linux, or we take the GNU project, which includes Linux in it. And why do they work so well for software? Why do they work for networking, operating systems, compilers, databases, graphics? Why don't they work for ISAs? There was, until recently, no open standard. We had these proprietary implementations, if it was the x86, if it was ARM, if it was the IBM 360, et cetera, but no free and open implementations. And that's not all. There really is a need for a single ISA. So if we take an SoC, such as this type of a thing, it has lots and lots of different blocks on them, which each have their own type of programmable processors inside. They may have application processors, which are really the main application processors are usually built on ARM today in these embedded systems. They will have graphic processors, image processors, radio DSPs, audio DSPs, security processors, power management processors, lots and lots of different processors. And a lot of them have their own proprietary software and software stack that's developed internally inside the company, or they run over different types of ISAs that are provided and so forth. And this really causes a headache and a problem, and it's hard to maintain and hard to develop, and it leads to a lot of bugs and so forth. A single ISA is invaluable. It provides us with a single software stack, no proprietary ISAs that may disappear, flexibility for various needs and features, and etc. Guess what? There's a solution to all this, and it's known as RISC-V. So in the summer of 2010, there was a three-month project at Berkeley that Kersta Sanovich, who was a star, a computer architect at Berkeley, he gave these two students here, Andrew Waterman and Yunsip Lee, a challenge to go and build the fifth version of a RISC architecture developed at Berkeley. So you have the RISC-1 that was developed by David Patterson, who kind of overviewed this whole project that went into different chips that you see over here. And the RISC-V architecture, which was developed by these two guys under Kirsty. And so in May 2014, it had already reached such interest in industry and so forth. Companies like Google and NVIDIA started to get interest in it that they decided to get to a point where they were going to freeze the base user spec, which we're going to be discussing. And in 2015, they established a foundation called the RISC-V Foundation. Nowadays, it's led by Calista Redmond, and it has over 3,100 members as of today. So RISC-V has a goal to become the industry standard ISA for all computing devices. It's supposed to be good for both small embedded devices and big high-end servers, just to replace all of those proprietary ISAs that exist and that you have to develop different software stack and a whole bunch of stuff just for each and every single one of those ISAs that you use. What is different about RISC-V? Well, it's simple. It's far smaller than other commercial ISAs if you just use the base spec. It has a clean slate design. It has a clear separation between the user and privileged ISAs. It avoids microarchitecture or technology-dependent features. And it doesn't have to be backwards compatible with all of those previous versions that may and instructions that may not be needed anymore. It's modular. So you start with a standard base ISA, and then you can extend it with multiple standard extensions or custom extensions in the vast opcode space that's given. So you can really take the base ISA and build off of it anything that you need for your specific application. It's very stable because the base and first standard extensions are frozen. They will never change. And the optional extensions are not new versions. They're just things that you can add or not add as you wish. And a big thing that has to do with everything open source nowadays, it's community designed. It's developed with leading industry and academic experts and software developers, which really gives it a good place for being a strong, secure, stable type of an instruction set. So why am I discussing all of this? Why did I discuss C and why did I discuss RISC-V? Because in this lecture, what we're going to do is we're going to cross the boundary between the software and the hardware. At the software side, we're going to take C as the high-level programming language. And that's because really it's the workhorse behind all embedded systems. And it really is the closest to the hardware that we can kind of see what is happening in the high-level code as we go down into the hardware. At the hardware side, we're going to use RISC-V because it's both open source and we're allowed to use it freely. It's very well explained and understood, and the decisions were made based on a lot of history and a lot of understanding of what's going on. And we can take that and look at how the assembly and machine language are there to support the high-level language that we have above. Specifically, we're going to use the 32-bit version of the RISC-V integer instructions, which is also known as RV32I. So this overview is going to show us how high-level programming constructs map to the CPU architecture that was introduced in the previous lecture. However, all of these concepts are applicable to any programming language and any instruction set architecture. So we could be using Java or C++ or Python or something else, and we could be, going over to x86 or ARM or something else. We're just going to be using C and RISC-V for convenience and because they're really easy to understand and easy to show.